want to tell you about a great new website. FantasyPickZ.com is made by some guys who are natives of Louisiana. It's a weekly pick'em website. FantasyPickZ.com is free to play. They're giving away iPad 2s each and every week. Coming up with basketball, baseball, golf, and other stuff, all the bowl games. FantasyPickZ.com. Go ahead and check that out next time you buy that computer. FantasyPickZ.com. With Richard Condon, I'm Tommy Kreiss, and Tigers roar. And right now, as we do just about each and every week, we are joined by Brian Lazar of TigerBait.com. Good evening, Brian. How are you?
Good. How you doing, Tommy?
Good, good. Your summary of your trip to Atlanta and LSU defeating the Georgia Bulldogs.
Well, you know, obviously everybody knows LSU got off to a really poor start offensively, and I think that, you know, LSU's offensive line had some problems blocking Georgia in the first half, and LSU just couldn't get anything going. And, you know, really, they were pretty fortunate that there were a couple of passes that could have been caught for touchdowns for Georgia, and they could have been ahead 21-0. But they didn't do that. Georgia really did everything it could in the first quarter, you know, the onside kick and came out and threw the football a lot. But it was only 10-0, and then Matthew makes the big punt return. It's only, when it's only 10-7 at half with the way LSU had played, you had to feel that it was, LSU was in pretty good shape. And, you know, they get the turnover right away to start the second half, score to go ahead, and then after holding Georgia, they get the good punt return by Matthew to put them right down there to score again. And once it got to 21-10, it was pretty much over.
Hey, Brian, good evening, buddy. How are you?
Good.
Hey, happy holidays. Merry Christmas early. Hey, Brian, what was the difference in the second half? Because we saw what LSU did against Arkansas in the second half. Talent took over. Depth took over. Obviously, LSU made adjustments against Arkansas in the second half. And would that be what you would think happened against Georgia? Pretty much LSU's talent took over. Their dominance took over in the second half, and they made adjustments at halftime based on what Auburn was, I mean, what Georgia was doing in the first half?
Well, I don't know. You know, defensively, first of all, you know, Georgia only gained 1 yard in the second quarter. They gained 134 yards in the first quarter, 1 yard in the second quarter. So after the first quarter, Georgia, you know, they didn't move the ball on them. Now, according to what offensive coordinator Greg Stadrala told me after the game, he said in the first half that Georgia was lifting their safeties a lot, so they did some things differently in different alignments in the second half where their safeties were going to have to be in such a situation which they could not blitz. So you put that in there, that may be a reason why LSU's running game worked a little bit better in the second half. But again, you know, they got, you know, great field position. You know, the fumble recovery, I think, came on about the 25, and Matthew returned the punt to inside the 20, so they really didn't have to move the ball too far for those two touchdowns. And then, like you said, we've seen this all year. You get in the third and fourth quarter, late third, fourth quarter, LSU just, you know, they just wear you down and just run the football, and that's just what they did. So I guess because of what Stadrala said, there probably was a, you know, one adjustment there. But then I think it's just a case of just LSU wearing down the opposing defenses.
We're visiting with Brian Lazar of TigerBait.com. Brian, your comments on Tyrann Mathieu being invited to New York, being a finalist for the Heisman Trophy, I was a little surprised that he got the invite. Certainly laying some groundwork for next year where he'll clearly be in the discussion. But your reaction to him being invited to New York?
Well, I just think that that's a reaction. I think a lot of people began to recognize him, and probably a lot of the votes came in for him after what he did Saturday. You know, this is, you know, a showcase game, and he made the punt return, which turned the momentum around, which he had done the week before against Arkansas. He makes two punt returns against Georgia. He forces a fumble, which sets up the go-ahead touchdown. So I just think it's the reaction, people just saying, look, every time we watch this guy play, he's out there making game-changing plays. And I think a lot of voters looked at him and said, I mean, this guy, I mean, he may be the best player on the best team in the country. So he probably got a lot of votes. I anticipate that he'll finish fourth in the balloting. But, you know, there's no doubt he's had a spectacular year, and now you know, we've watched him play for 2 years, and he's very good at making plays for that LSU defense.
Hey, Brian, you know, I know I'm a little bit older than you, obviously, but back in 1977, I remember when LSU promoted Charles Alexander for the Heisman. They had bumper stickers all over town. Alexander the Great, he was a finalist. He finished ninth in the Heisman voting. But, Brian, would you ever imagine it would take 34 years after the last serious contender for the Heisman that LSU would have a gentleman in New York with a chance?
Well, you know, I think you got to have a special player or a special team. And, you know, LSU's had that this year. And, you know, offensively, you know, during this good run in the 2000s, you know, when you look at, okay, great players, Glenn Dorsey, great player, but again, a defensive player, and he missed some games the senior year. Jamarcus Russell, number one pick in the NFL draft, if you recall his senior season, the two big games at Auburn and at Florida, he didn't play very well. So you have to be on a good team, have talent, and make plays in big games, and that's just something that Matthew's done, and LSU hasn't had, you know, players that do that. You know, they've had the national championship team in 03 and 07, but really didn't have that type of player on either one of those two teams.
All right, Brian, we got several weeks to get ready for LSU and Alabama, and we'll be talking to you as we go forward with that, especially that Wednesday night before the Monday night contest. Brian, tell the folks what they're going to get when they go to TigerBait.com.
Lots of, we'll keep up the football coverage of these next few weeks, getting ready for the championship game against Alabama, and basketball coverage, and we're keeping up with the recruiting coverage now. You know, LSU's got 21 commitments, so they only got four slots open, so it'll be very interesting to see who gets these last four spots for them.
Brian Lazar, TigerBait.com, as always, we appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. That's Brian Lazar, TigerBait.com. When we come back, a little more Heisman Trophy talk for you. Richard Cotton and Tommy Chrisand. Spread the roar. You're watching Tigers Roar on Pelican Sports TV. Baton Rouge, Lafayette, New Orleans. Online at PelicanSportsTV.com.
Hello, I'm Rohan David, and you're watching Pelican Sports TV.
For the thirsty, for those who hang out in packs, for heroes, for sidekicks, for those who see the glass half empty, for those who see it half full, for those on the right, for those on the left, for those with nicknames, for those with curves, for people that cycle, for people that recycle, for BFFs, for frenemies, for those with style, for lovers, for families, for big families, for everyone.
The family dental practice of Dr. Farrell Frugier Jr. and our highly trained staff are dedicated to providing care and treatment to our patients of all ages in all aspects of dental care. 23 years of experience and advanced training in cosmetic and restorative dentistry, TMJ, and treatment of snoring and sleep apnea allows Dr. Frugier to assist you in achieving the best in dental health. Call us today at 292-9700 to schedule your initial evaluation, because we know how to make you smile.
BetterBatonRougeJobs.com has been extremely beneficial for the Team Automotive Group. And what stands out to us, it's easy to use, not only for us, but it's easy for the applicants. And it's the quality of applicants that we get. It's timely. We post something in the morning. By that afternoon, we have double-digit applicants. And again, it's the quality of the applicants.
Employers, now is a great time to hire, recruit, and look for potential new employees.
BetterBatonRougeJobs.com. It's free for job seekers and great for business.
Total Occupational Medicine has been treating injured workers and providing drug tests and employment physicals in our community with a staff of certified professionals for over 20 years. Conveniently located at 3333 Drusilla Lane at I-12, Total Occupational Medicine can assess your needs and present a plan to get your injured workers back to work as soon as medically appropriate. Call Jim Bollinger or Dennis Taylor at 924-4460 to put the experienced team at Total Occupational Medicine to work for you today. That's 924-4460.
With Tigers Roar, a little Heisman Trophy talk for you. It'll be given away this Saturday night in New York, as we just talked with Brian Lazar of TigerBait.com. Tyron Matthew will be there. Of course, Billy Cannon won the Heisman Trophy in 1959. He had finished third the year before. He's the only Heisman Trophy winner from LSU. An interesting history of LSU win Heisman Trophy people. 1962, you know, other than Cannon finishing first, Stovall finished second in 1962. Many people thought he should have got it, including me and myself.
One of the biggest ripoffs ever. Terry Baker.
Burt Jones.
Out of Oregon State,
Burt Jones was fourth in 72. That surprised you
See,
a little bit.
See, it does. I can't wait to get home and check out my NCAA record books because, I mean, I went through it.
Is that one of the books in the Condon Library?
It is.
At home in the back of the house with the little ladder thing on the wall?
I got that Cat in a Hat, The Best of Mama Duke.
Yeah, okay.
I got a great collection.
I bet you
I even
did.
Got a couple of books by Richard Condon. I tell people I wrote it. A
couple of De La Salle yearbooks.
As soon as I started talking, though, they realized it wasn't me. A
couple of De La Salle yearbooks
yeah,
up there?
No. Those were going a long time ago.
Okay.
But you know what time you look at it, in Jerry Stovall, that's a guy who should have won it. If any Tiger should have won the Heisman and didn't, it would have been him. And, you know, Burt Jones, you can argue that point because he finished fourth. It's not like he was runner-up. And then everybody knows who's been following LSU football since Sid Crocker was the voice of Tiger Stadium in the yellow chair back seats. And the Boy Scouts actually knew how to get you to your seat those days. And back then, everybody met by the airplane because there wasn't any other landmark at that time.
Right.
But, 75 years. And you would think of all the great athletes that have come through that program. All the great athletes, especially skilled athletes, that's what Louisiana's been known for years. But 75 years, this will be the 75th year, and only two LSU football players have ever finished in the top two in a voting.
And the name I don't see on this list, and to keep up with the list, Charles Alexander finished ninth in 77, fifth in 78. Dorsey finished ninth in 2007. I don't see Tommy Casanova's name on here. That's one of the greatest guys everywhere. Greatest athletes to ever.
And I looked
play
that
football.
Up last night. It was either 71 or 72. I think it was 72. But they list the top nine finishers, and he didn't finish in the top.
That's
nine.
Amazing how that Casanova did.
And, you know, talking about Charles Alexander.
I remember the Alexander the Great stickers.
Let me share this with you, Specs. I looked it up in Peter Finney's book, you know, the history of LSU football, especially since LSU was taken on Oregon in Jerry's Palace. You know, I just wanted to look up because I remember being in Tiger Stadium, U-28. It's where my parents had their seats, and I was 17, junior in high school, whatever. And they took on Rich Brooks, who went on to coach the Rams, took on Rich Brooks as Oregon Ducks. And LSU was up 50-something to like 10 with a few minutes to go. And Coach McClendon, Alexander, off tackle, Alexander around right end. And he finished with like 230-something yards. And obviously what they were doing is trying to push him for the Heisman Trophy. But after that game, Rich Brooks, you want to talk about upset about the fact that Charles Alexander was still in the game getting the football.
Didn't they have a poster, Hodson for Heisman? Of course, Tommy Hodson. Wasn't that? I mean, I know it was a last minute.
Yeah, I think it was 80.
It came out during the season.
I believe it was 87.
But I remember seeing
Hodson.
Right,
no, there was. LSU did a
poster. Wasn't it a poster?
Yeah, after the 86 season because they won the SEC championship. In 87, I believe that somebody started promoting him for Heisman, but his senior year wasn't as productive as his junior year. And I think pretty much it faded away. But, yeah, initially they promoted Tommy for the Heisman.
Yeah, and I remember those. And Tommy may be watching tonight. I don't know. But I remember those posters. Now, okay, Tyrann Mathieu, you know, Brian thinks he'll finish fourth. Nobody thinks he's going to win it. But it's an honor. It's a credit to St. Augustine High School and LSU and the state of Louisiana and his school, LSU, to be selected to be there. And only five guys are there. But he is laying the groundwork, as we said, for next year, and he'll be in that conversation. Do you think LSU, who's not been known, you know, what, Oregon put the poster of Joey Heatherton in Times Square in New York, Jerry Harrington, whatever his name was, other schools have sent out all kind of Heisman propaganda and flyers and DVDs and books and, you know, you name it.
I think what helps LSU here.
But you think LSU will, knowing that Heisman
went this year.
I think they will
to a certain extent.
They're not going to go crazy
with it. But not this multi-million dollar.
No
PR move, because
no life.
If you get to the national championship game, even if you lose, everybody's going to be talking about Tyrann Mathieu being a junior. If you win that game, well, all preseason magazines and all the hype leading into the 2012 season, Mathieu automatically will get the national exposure and be promoted for the Heisman. I'm sure LSU will assist along that road, but it's not like, say, LSU finished, 7-5. And, yeah, they went to a bowl, but really didn't get a whole lot of national recognition. Well, LSU's getting all the national recognition any team could want, and a player that's going to be in New York who's going to be a junior next year, that'll all play out.
We got more for you. Stay with us. You are tuned to Tigers Roar live on a Wednesday night from 8 to 10 p.m. We also have replays in numerous markets, so we appreciate you catching that, including WHNO-TV, Channel 20 out in New Orleans. That airs in the North Shore, St. Tammany Parish, Washington Parish, all of that area. Down in Bayou Country, Lafourche Parish and Terrebonne Parish, Mississippi Gulf Coast. That's Fridays from 5 to 7 p.m. with our good friends at WHNO-TV down there in New Orleans. We got more for you. Richard Kind and Tommy Chrisand. Stay with us.
Hi, I'm attorney Kerry Bryson. My law firm focuses specifically on helping people try to solve their IRS tax problems. Lately, so many new out-of-state companies are popping up claiming that if you send them money, they can resolve your IRS problems. Well, what happens if they don't? Do you hire an attorney? Maybe you should start with a local attorney that's already handled hundreds of IRS cases right here in Louisiana. When you hire the Bryson Law Firm, you won't be speaking long distance or sending money to some out-of-town high-pressure salesman. You'll meet with us in person at our office right here in Baton Rouge. Your first visit is completely free and confidential, and we'll tell you on the spot exactly how much it'll cost. So if you're hiring a company to resolve your IRS wage levies, bank levies, or tax liens, check their reputation first, then call me, Kerry Bryson, or go to BrysonLawFirm.com. If you're a Louisiana resident and you have an IRS problem, hire a Louisiana attorney, Kerry Bryson.
Hello, my name is Debbie. Welcome to Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair.
Come see the many great lines we carry in bridal. Bridesmaids, mothers, flower girls, tuxes, and more. We also carry over 25 top designer lines in debutante gowns, Mardi Gras, pageant, and prom. Come meet me and my staff with over 30 years of bridal and pageant experience. Debbie's Bridal, a formal affair, Burnside and Gonzales, where service matters.
The family dental practice of Dr. Farrell Frugier Jr. and our highly trained staff are dedicated to providing care and treatment to our patients of all ages in all aspects of dental care. 23 years of experience and advanced training in cosmetic and restorative dentistry, TMJ, and treatment of snoring and sleep apnea allows Dr. Frugier to assist you in achieving the best in dental health. Call us today at 292-9700 to schedule your initial evaluation, because we know how to make you smile.
We continue with Tigers Roar. Of course, LSU's in the BCS Championship game Monday night, January the 9th, kickoff a little bit after 7:30 Louisiana time. Also in New Orleans on December 17th, that's a Saturday night, week from this Saturday, Coach Mark Hudspeth, ULL, Raging Cajuns, went 8-4 this year, created some excitement in Lafayette. Attendance was up. You know, they did a very good job in the Sun Belt. They didn't win it, but they'll be in the New Orleans Bowl. So tip of the hat, a lot of those Cajun fans are going to make that trip to New Orleans and spend the weekend over there. They'll play against San Diego State. I don't know much about San Diego State, but tip of the hat to Mark Hudspeth and the ULL Raging Cajuns. Richard, we had Mark on this program. He made us take all the LSU stuff down, and we can live with that. But he came over here with one of his assistant coaches, a good friend of mine, Timmy Rebo, and we talked to him right after he got hired, and he was excited about his season, and it had a really good one. It's also been announced he will return to ULL for the 2012 season. There was some talk his name might fly out there at Tulane or Ole Miss or Mississippi State, but Mississippi State job didn't open, but it was some speculation. So tip of the hat to the Raging Cajuns. ULL had their best football season in a very long time, first bowl game since 1970, and Mark Hudspeth and his staff get a lot of credit. Also, Louisiana Tech, for the first time since 2001, they won their conference. They are the WAC conference champions. They will play TCU, tall order there, but they'll play TCU out in San Diego on December 21st in the Poinsettia Bowl. You didn't know about the Poinsettia
Bowl.
I've heard of it. But tip of the hat to Sonny Dykes.
It's not necessarily on my bucket list, but I have heard of it.
Sonny Dykes and the Bulldogs of Louisiana Tech up there in Ruston. Obviously, they're not in our viewing audience, but three Louisiana teams going bowling for the first time in a while. Tulane hired a coach, Curtis Johnson, from the New Orleans Saints, but he's a New Orleans guy, a St. Charles Parish guy, who has had success at the collegiate level. He was part of the Miami coaching staff in 01 that won a national title. Here's a tough job for Curtis Johnson to try to get Tulane going. But, you know, Greenway football, you grew up right by it. I did, too, being out in Chalmette and, you know, had guys in the neighborhood that played football at Tulane and that kind of stuff.
Losing fans and the River Parishes had to push the winning fans and wheelbarrows.
Oh,
remember,
yeah,
that was a tradition.
Well, the same
for you.
Thing. Things. Was 73 when Mark Oliveri and Green Wave knocked him off 14-0. Darwin, Willie, and crew. So
Terry Looney,
yeah. So anyway, Curtis Johnson, the new head coach for the
I think,
Green
you know
Wave.
What, Tom? I think that's the only time I ever cried at a game.
What? When Tulane beat LSU
70,000 Tulane Stadium? And, you know,
how many?
I'm not 78,000. Yeah. And I'm not saying it was split, but it was 60-40. Tulane a lot of fans back then. They had a loyal following.
Right.
I mean, because LSU and Tulane had some competitive games in the 50s, but then obviously by the early 80s, that program started going down besides the 82 game. I don't want to talk about that.
First, we don't either, but neither does Alan Richard. But anyway, the first college football game I ever saw, I was in the Cub Scouts. You were talking about the Cub Scouts earlier. Upper deck, Tulane Stadium, the Tulane Green Wave versus the Ramblin' Wreck of Georgia Tech. They brought the little car thing out there. I thought that was a cool deal. First college football game I ever saw was Tulane versus Georgia Tech. I'm going to guess it was 67, 8, or 9, right up in late 60s. So
the latest,
1970.
They began tearing Tulane Stadium down in 75. And 75 was the first season the Saints played in the Dome.
Right.
75. You know who the last football game, what was the last football game ever played in Tulane Stadium? The very last football game ever played in Tulane Stadium.
A Sugar Bowl?
Old Catholic League. High school football game.
Really?
Rummel beat De La Salle 20-17.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Boy, I'm learning stuff
every
day.
That's the last game ever played in old Tulane Stadium. And I know a lot of people, young, listening, you know, in New Orleans and the area that Pelican and Tiger Road gets to, a lot of people my age, your age, and a little bit older, man, I remember some special days in old Tulane Stadium.
Remember the ZZ
that
Top
place,
concert?
That place rocked. I mean, the metal beams. And you remember the Visqueen on a Sunday?
Yeah.
Because one guy would bring the Visqueen, and it would start storming, and all the Saints fans underneath, and you had the guy with the rocket pack on his back with the little beer, dispensing the beer.
Right.
At the ostrich races, Battle of New Orleans. Guy came down with the ball, had the rocket thing. Just old school.
Yeah.
And then what everybody did, Tommy, they came up to Baton Rouge. And back then, the Interstate 10 stopped at Highland Road. You didn't get off at College or Acadian. There was no such thing. Interstate 10 got off at Highland.
You
went Highland
left.
Road. You took
a
left.
Had a big sign says LSU.
And the old Mike Anderson's was right there, and he posted the score right before you got into campus. And then you went back home the same way. Highland Road took forever after the game. Highland Road.
Right.
All of those people to get people going back to New Orleans. People went home, got home about 3 in the morning, got a couple of nights sleep. I mean, a couple hours sleep. Got up, went to church for an hour or two, and then boom, tried to find a driveway to park off of Willow Street, a Tulane Stadium, because there was no parking lot. It was all neighborhood, shotgun houses.
I did go to a couple Saints games as a kid down there with Tulane Stadium. That was a special place. A lot of good Sugar Bowls were played in there. A couple of Super Bowls were played in the place when Hank Stram and the Chiefs beat the Vikings. That was in that building. Dempsey's field goal. I mean, you know, a lot of stuff happened in that stadium, and it's not been
and we
there
keep
for
talking like this.
People
are going to have that mothball smell in their house. But, you know, the one thing about it, I will never forget going to see the Dolphins take on the Cowboys
in
Tulane Stadium. Super Bowl 4 or 5, I forget. But it was in the 70s.
Was the Chiefs and the Vikings.
And, Tom, I'll never forget it. Me and my dad are walking, and you had people all over with hands of tickets. And he bought two tickets to the Super Bowl for $10.
Wow.
Two tickets to the Super Bowl for
$10.
That's how much the game has changed.
Face value price on the tickets for LSU Alabama, $350. Not $3 a bit.
Somebody told me back in 2007 it was like 100 and something less.
190, I
something
thought.
Something like that. Yeah.
Anyway. Hey, Richard, it's 35 bowl games. There's no way we can get into all of them. I got a comment.
Right.
Arizona State's playing UCLA. They both fired their coaches, but they're in bowl games. I mean, 35 is too many
That
bowls.
Leads me to this.
What?
And I've heard this argument for years, and I've gone off on it for years. When I hear somebody say there are absolutely way too many bowl games.
Way too many.
Well, guess what? I think that's totally absurd. I think that's ridiculous. Because if
Richard,
I'm...
you need to make a phone
my
call?
Bad. No, okay. No, my bad. If I'm sitting home and I'm watching these games for free, I got a choice, right? I can watch a football game.
Or
I can watch Dr.
Son.
Phil on Channel 19.
Or Sanford and Son.
I can watch Bait Car. I can watch Forensic Files. I can watch Pawn Star. Boy, one night I was going through the channels. I'm going, man, they putting that stuff on regular cable now? Then I got a guy trying to sell a Civil War, you know, belt buckle. I'm going, son of a bug, I ain't going to get it. So anyway, but Tom, like when you go to your relatives, right? And God bless my in-laws, and no, they are no longer with me. But you know, they all get together, and Aunt Poo-Poo comes in, and Uncle B.B., you know that stuff, extended family stuff. I'm the only kid, so I mean, I'm not used to that. Well, man, that gave me an escape. I could sit back and watch 2 6-5 teams play a football game. It's a football game. It's free. If you don't want to watch it, change the channel. I don't understand how people complain. There is no such thing as a couple of things in life, and one I won't say. But there is no such thing as too much football. It's free. It's a football game. It gets you through the holidays. I never got that. I never got how there's too much football.
How many of the 35 bowl games are you going to watch? Like 18, 19 of them?
I watch most of them. Okay. I mean, as you get to, you know, the serious bowls.
The
January 2nd bowls. Yeah, I watch all of them. But like these midweek games, you know, and I don't have it in front of me. But like if a New Mexico State is taking on
Utah.
Yeah, I mean, I may watch a quarter or something like that. And if it's exciting, I may check back in an hour and a half. And if it's really exciting, a team's down by 3 and they got their ball at the 20 with one timeout, you know, I'm going to see what they're going to do. But the thing that excites me besides watching LSU in a bowl game, I love watching the SEC against the Big Ten. Anytime the SEC takes on a Big Ten, you know, like last year with Florida did to Penn State and Alabama drubbed Michigan State.
Mississippi State beat
drew Michigan. And the only loss was Arkansas losing to Ohio State.
And they shouldn't have lost because Ohio State cheated.
And I'm excited about the bowl matchup because you got four of them again. I mean, you got four of them again. I mean, you got Georgia taking on Michigan State in the Outback. You got the Gator Bowl with Florida and Ohio State. You got the Capital One, South Carolina and Nebraska. And then you got Arkansas and Kansas State. Even though, you know, that's Big 12, but still I'm looking forward to seeing that. And besides those four games, the one game I'm really looking forward to seeing is the Fiesta Bowl. You know, I want to see what Luck does.
Right.
I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing the Fiesta Bowl. I really am. So
Stanford and Oklahoma State.
Stanford
you know,
Oklahoma and Oklahoma State.
Hey, 35 bowls, three of them are, in New Orleans because you got the New Orleans Bowl where ULL will play San Diego State. You got the Sugar Bowl, Michigan and Virginia Tech, and, of course, the BCS. So from December 17 and January 9th, three bowl games in the Crescent City.
I'm not a big fan. I used to like it when, and again, this is pretty much pre-BCS for the most part, but I used to like it, Tom, when the Cotton Bowl started at 10. And I remember my dad bringing TVs out of every room. It's before you could have pitcher-in-pitcher. You know, you had the little six-inch here with the little Dalmatian dog there, and then you had the other one with the volcano lamp on that one. You know, you had TVs all over the room, and you were just doing this. And I liked it when the final game was the Orange Bowl that night, and it was over. But you had like 8 games that day.
Right.
It was just all day long, and then that was it. It's not like it is now. Then you got another bowl after the main day. Then you got the BCS bowl. So it's changed now, but I used to like that one day when it was done.
And I went to a few Sugar Bowls in my day, some in the old. I think I went to one in Tulane Stadium, and I went to a couple of them in the Alabama, Penn State. I was at that game. Georgia, Pitt, I was at that game. So I went to a few of them. I mean, Sugar Bowl, you and I growing up in New Orleans was always a special time of the year.
Not to bore anybody with this, but my fondest memory about that is my dad was a New Orleans police officer, and his job was to follow Johnny Majors around. You know, from the hotel to the stadium, on the sideline with him. As you see the police officers, as halftime comes and the end of the game, to go out and shake hands. And I was just watching on TV, and I saw my dad, whatever. And I'll never forget. So a couple hours later, he come home. He said, what you still doing up? I said, Dad, I was waiting for you to come home. He said, I got something for you. Well, you know, he pulled the garage, and the police car's in there. And he goes, what? He says, stay right here. Well, Tommy, he came in, and he had a Pitt helmet. Mustard. You remember that old mustard color? And Ricky Jackson and Hugh Green and who I'm thinking of?
Marino
and Cogburn, all of those guys. And had the Pitt White Sox. And it had the three blue stripes with the little Pitt Panther walking across the top of it. I still got the Pitt helmet. I thought that was a fine little color combo.
Yeah.
Still got that. Who knows where those socks went. But, yeah, I'll never forget that. And he said Johnny Majors was the nicest guy in the world.
Very good. That's cool. That's an interesting story. Very, very, very cool. When we come back, we'll be joined by Ronnie Rance of Sports Shorts TV and Sports Shorts Radio. He was at the LSU-Georgia game. He's also got some information for you LSU baseball and college baseball fans. Richard Condon, Tommy Chrisant, stay with us. We got more right here on Tigers Roar.
BetterBatonRougeJobs.com has been extremely beneficial for the Team Automotive Group. And what stands out to us, it's easy to use, not only for us, but it's easy for the applicants. And it's the quality of applicants that we get. It's timely. We post something in the morning. By that afternoon, we have double-digit applicants. And again, it's the quality of the applicants.
Employers, now is a great time to hire, recruit, and look for potential new employees.
BetterBatonRougeJobs.com. It's free for job seekers and great for business.
You're on the same flight.
We'll be on the same flight.
Yeah,
we're
going to work. Anything together? Do we know that?
Got it.
Thanks, Dave.
The big, brilliant, thin Samsung Infuse 4G. Only from the network of possibilities, AT&T.
For the thirsty, for those who hang out in packs, for heroes, for sidekicks, for those who see the glass half empty, for those who see it half full, for those on the right, for those on the left, for those with nicknames, for those with curves, for people that cycle, for people that recycle, for BFFs, for frenemies, for those with style, for lovers, for families, for big families, for everyone.
Pelican Sports TV presents Pelican Radio. Get ready to mix it up with me, Tommy Chrisant, and Chris Landry weekday afternoons from 3 to 4 p.m. Pro sports, college sports, high school sports, and much more on The Score 1210 a.m. and on the internet at thescore1210.com.
40 years, 4 decades, nearly half a century. That's how long the citizens of Greater Baton Rouge have chosen Richards Honda. A simple, sincere, and honest process.
Louisiana's oldest and most experienced Honda dealership for over 40 years, Richards Honda.
We continue with Tigers Roar here on Pelican Sports TV, Baton Rouge, Lafayette, and New Orleans. Richard Condon and Tommy Chrisant, and we remind you, Joe Johnson is coming back to town to give you the best deals on cars. Yeah, he's been in the car business for a long time. Look for Joe at the North American Automotive Group, 13557 Airline Highway in Gonzales. Joe Johnson, he's ready to wheel and deal and make you a deal on a used car. Again, look for Joe Johnson at the North American Automotive Group, Airline Highway in Gonzales. We continue with Tigers Roar, and at this time we're joined by Ronnie Rance of Sports Shorts TV, Sports Shorts Radio. Ronnie, how you doing?
Hey, guys.
Go ahead, Ronnie, you there?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, man.
How was that LSU-Georgia game? I know you were in Atlanta.
Yeah, I mean, it was a great game. I mean, obviously it was a bizarre game in that, you know, LSU was so inept on offense in the first half with not really doing anything, but yet, you know, only down 3 points at halftime. And, you know, was in the locker room at halftime. The locker room was spirited like you would expect it to be. A lot of yelling and screaming, a lot of cursing going on between the coaches and the players. But, you know, the one thing the players kept saying is, and the coaches kept saying was, hey, look, they've played as well as they can. They've given it their best shot. They've come out hot. But yet, we're only down 3 points. We're going to get it together. We're not going to go down like this. And we're going to play better in the second half. So they were fully confident. They realized they played their worst half of the season, but still were only down by three. And on the other end, Les Miles and Coach Studd were on the chalkboard in the side office. And the plan was to throw the ball a lot in the second half because they knew Georgia was basically crowding the line, just challenging LSU to throw it. As it turned out, Tigers didn't have to throw it much in the second half because they got a break early on and got some short fields and, you know, built up the score, and then they just ran it. But the plan was that they knew, hey, we got to throw the football because they were just challenging LSU to do that.
Ronnie, you were at the game. Some people told me it was about 60-40% Georgia fans of LSU. Would that be what you thought it was?
Yeah, definitely. There were definitely a few more Georgia fans than Tiger fans, which was to be expected.
Yeah, they're 70 miles away in Athens and all of that good stuff. And a lot of the LSU fans that I talked to didn't want to make the trip to Atlanta and to New Orleans for the BCS Bowl. The families, the people who could only do one trip, we're going to do the New Orleans thing. Ronnie Rantz, you and I were talking earlier today. Major League Baseball has made some changes in the draft and when it'll take place and when signings can take place. Tell everybody about that and how it'll affect not just LSU baseball, but ULL, Tulane, and college baseball in general.
Yeah, you know, the CBD, the collective bargaining agreement, the CBA rather, the between Major League Baseball and the players and the owners, which, of course, you know, they, unlike basketball and football, there was no lockout, there was no strike. It got done pretty smoothly. But one of the things that was put in there that hasn't gotten a lot of national attention and, of course, will affect this area because we're crazy for college baseball in Louisiana, and that is the signing date, which has been generally the middle of August. You're looking at, you know, maybe a week or so, a week or two at the most before the start of school. That signing period between the amateur players and Major League Baseball has been moved up a month. So now it's the middle of July where now the teams and the players will have to make a decision. You know, that deadline, if the high school player or the college player doesn't sign with Major League Baseball, then they will, you know, go to college. And that's big for LSU and Tulane and ULL because if they do lose a player, they still have a month, maybe even 5 weeks, you know, to sign a guy to get a replacement. Lets them know sooner what's going on. It gives them some other options. And then the other caveat to it, which is a real big one, is that now, like in football and like in basketball, more like basketball, there's a cap on the signing bonuses that are given to these players. So now these players are going to be slotted. You're going to basically know, you know, what you're going to get, and there's not going to be any, you know, 20th round picks getting $1 million anymore. Where, you know, pretty much you're going to be wherever you're drafted. There's going to be a slot for you, and you're not going to be able to go over that slot. And if you do play a player with, say, in the 10th round, maybe first or second round money, then that team's going to be penalized heavily by Major League Baseball with a tax, and you could lose future picks. So it's going to help the game of college baseball. All that said, all the rules are going to help college baseball. It's going to make more. It's going to make more players go to college baseball. Maybe you're not going to lose as many players to the pros out of high school, and you're liable to keep some players for their senior year. So it's going to be a good thing for LSU down the line.
Hey, Ronnie, how you doing, buddy?
Hey, Richard, good to hear from you.
All right, same here. Hey, Ronnie, this trend we're seeing, we saw it in the offseason with the Eagles. They were going to build that perfect team, like that 70s show, the Million Dollar Man. Then we see Bosch, and then we see Wade, and then we see LeBron James in Miami. That didn't really work out perfectly. Now we're seeing Reyes and maybe Pujols playing for the Miami Marlins. And now they're talking about Chris Paul and Dwight Howard going out to L.A. to become the perfect team. Ronnie, is that a trend we're going to see in all three major sports for the short term?
For the short period, yeah, but the long term, no, because that one of the things the NBA is trying to do is to prevent that. That's what they're trying to do, is make it so that a player can make so much more money by re-signing with his team, that a Kevin Durant can make so much more money by staying in Oklahoma, that he's going to give up the chance to maybe go win a championship in Miami because he's going to make $10 million more a year by staying in the city he's currently in. And so I think as we go forward, the trend is going to be to reward those players financially so greatly that they just give up the opportunity to go be on a super team because it's life-changing money, not only for them, but their grandkids and everybody else in their world.
Hey, Ronnie, and this has been talked about at least through especially the second half of this LSU football season. Coming back, becoming dominant in the second half against ranked teams, saw it against Arkansas, again saw it in the SEC championship game. And that one word continues to come up, Ronnie, chemistry, chemistry. You played on a couple of LSU baseball teams that had it. It had chemistry. They were able to overcome obstacles, a little adversity here and there like this team has. What's the definition, I guess, of that? I think I know, Ronnie, but how does it get to that point amongst a group of athletes where it just simply all comes together and everybody's got one another's back during good and bad times?
I think more than the kumbaya part, which people put a lot of credit into, which is, oh, we all like each other, we all get along. I think it's more having the same goals and the same vision, and of course you got to have great leadership. In 1991, our LSU baseball team that won the first national championship, we had a lot of interesting personalities. They didn't always get along. We had a lot of fights in the locker room. We had fights on the field. Guys that necessarily weren't the best of friends. Where in 1993, we won the national championship, and that team, you know, was a totally different vibe. It was a lot more chill, and it was a lot more laid back, and everybody kind of got along. So, you know, you can do it different ways, but I think the common goal, and you have to have all, whether it be a football team, all 85 guys, or whether it be a baseball team, all 25 guys, you have to truly all be buying into whatever the coaches are selling and have one vision and one goal and put all the individual things behind you. And I think that's more important than the hall. We get along and we all hang out at Shady's Bar together.
Ronnie, tell us about first Sports Shorts Radio, then Sports Shorts TV, and a very special guest. You always have a special guest, but one that people are going to want to hear from this coming week.
Well, Sports Shorts Radio, we're excited about Tommy. It's every Saturday morning from 10 to noon, and it's on 104.5 FM ESPN Radio in Baton Rouge. Myself and Chad Bluen each and every Saturday morning over live at Gambino's Restaurant. This week we'll only be on from 10 to 11 due to the fact of carrying the high school football state championships. But on Mondays, Mondays and Tuesday nights right here on Pelican Broadcasting, we've got the Sports Shorts TV, Mondays at 8, Tuesdays at 9 p.m., and as you mentioned, Chad and I do that show. We always have a special guest in the second half hour. We've got Paul Menary, Skip Berman, and others on. This week, we're going to have Dale Brown on. And not only will he be on this week, but it'll be a two-part interview, and we'll have him on next week as well. And if anybody knows Dale Brown, he's one of the best interviews in the business, super entertaining. He's got a new book out. He's got a new documentary movie that's out. And, of course, we'll get into some of the great stories of his days at LSU. So we're really excited and looking forward to having Dale Brown on this coming next 2 weeks.
Ronnie Rance, as always, we appreciate it. We'll talk to you again real soon.
All right, thanks, Richard and Tommy. Y'all have a good one.
I think he was going to say something else.
Hey, Ron.
I cut him off. He's done.
Anyway, hey, Ronnie, Merry Christmas to you and your family.
Oh, I know. Okay, yeah. From Richard and all of us, Merry Christmas. I cut him off before you could say that. I'm sorry. All right, we come back. We got more stuff for you. Tigers Roar right here on Pelican Sports TV.
One of the key attributes that really puts Papa John's pizza over the top is our meats. Nobody does what Papa John's does.
For just $11, get our new double-layered premium pepperoni pizza, loaded with a layer of our signature pepperoni, plus a layer of oversized deli-style pepperoni. Just $11 for a large. Plus, get double points all weekend long and earn free pizza fast with Papa Rewards, only at PapaJohns.com. Sign up now.
Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's.
Explore the charms of the North Shore and visit St. Tammany Parish. Whether you're looking for a cultural experience or an adventure, you'll find it here. Enjoy great attractions and fantastic dining in a relaxed and friendly atmosphere.
Come visit us and discover the history and heritage that is Louisiana's North Shore.
For more information, log on to LouisianaNorthShore.com/BB.
Hi, I'm attorney Kerry Bryson. My law firm focuses specifically on helping people try to solve their IRS tax problems. Lately, so many new out-of-state companies are popping up claiming that if you send them money, they can resolve your IRS problems. Well, what happens if they don't? Do you hire an attorney? Maybe you should start with a local attorney that's already handled hundreds of IRS cases right here in Louisiana. When you hire the Bryson Law Firm, you won't be speaking long distance or sending money to some out-of-town high-pressure salesman. You'll meet with us in person at our office right here in Baton Rouge. Your first visit is completely free and confidential, and we'll tell you on the spot exactly how much it'll cost. So if you're hiring a company to resolve your IRS wage levies, bank levies, or tax liens, check their reputation first, then call me, Kerry Bryson, or go to BrysonLawFirm.com. If you're a Louisiana resident and you have an IRS problem, hire a Louisiana attorney, Kerry Bryson.
We continue with Tigers Roar. You know, all year long, actually a year and a half, we've been doing Tigers Roar. Our staff, which is very talented, Chris LeCocq and Carter Bryant and Michael Schakowsky and all of that, have been putting a lot of different things together for you. Everything from the eating the grass to, you know, all kind of good stuff. And then Carter Bryant has done a super job with challenging some of the, like Mo Isom, the soccer player, to a goal kick and He's done stuff with the hammer throw and with Walter Hannon. He's done all kinds of stuff. Well, we got a feature for you tonight. It's kind of a field event challenge with our Carter Bryant and some of the members of the LSU track and field team. Enjoy this, then we'll come back and put a wrap on it.
Carter Bryant once again out here for Tigers Roar, Pelican Broadcasting. We're out here with Aaron Moore. And here's the thing. We just interviewed Kim Duncan, and she is phenomenal. She can do everything on 100, 200, 4x100. Just interviewed Coach Shaver as well. But you're a javelin thrower, yes. Aaron. I mean, what is javelin exactly? I mean, is it just a sport where you throw a stick really far?
Well, you could say that, but the javelin, for those who, you know, people who don't know, it's about 8.5, 9 feet long. It weighs just under 2 pounds, 800 grams. And when you start off, you just kind of throw it and you chunk it. But then, you know, where we are, I'm a senior right now, so I'm really working on a lot of finesse things to really take my throw to the next level. So it's not just throwing it with your arm, it's a lot more body.
So you're the field part of track and field. What are some other field events, and can this be a strong field squad for the Tigers this season?
Well, we definitely have a strong field squad. My teammate with thrower, Max Lauro, hammer thrower, he's a four-time All-American. And then what also is composed of the field is the throwers as well as all the jumps. So we have DeMar Forbes, who just competed in the Worlds, and he's doing really well. And we have a lot of jumpers along with us throwers. And so typically with LSU being a sprint school, that's what it's been in the past, but now since I've been here, we've kind of brought it into the field a lot more too. So we're looking to score a lot of points, and if we can get our share done and the sprinters can, you know, keep doing what they're doing, then we're definitely going to go far this year.
This season, I'm really excited because we have a lot of depth in our events, and we have a lot of extra people. And last year and the years before, we didn't have a high jumper. We didn't have a lot of discus throwers. This year, we have 3 discus throwers. We just got a lot of people and a lot of opportunities to score points.
So can this be a team national championship this year for LSU?
I definitely think so. And this is my fourth year. In the past three years, we've always been top 5. And this year, we have a lot of returning seniors that all look promising, a lot of hard workers. And we also have a whole bunch of freshmen coming in that are really skilled. So, you know, that freshman dynamic with track and field, it's very up and down. You never know who's going to show up. Hopefully all of our guys are going to show up on a consistent basis in the postseason, and we'll show up and hopefully take down everybody else.
We're about to partake in hammer, correct? Mm-hmm. And last year I went up against Walter Henning in weight throwing. Right. What's the difference between the two?
The technique is pretty much the same. It's just the weight is a lot heavier, so it's slowed down, doesn't go as far. The hammer, it's a lot more finesse. A lot of strong guys who can throw the weight pretty far can't throw the hammer because they don't have the skill and the patience to wait for the hammer to keep coming around because it's so much longer.
How do you think I can do as a javeler?
I think you could do pretty well. I mean, we've talked before, you know, but I think you could, let's say, estimate, after a day's worth of practice, I'll give you about 120 feet.
Are you going to kick my butt?
I'm pretty sure. I had one throw, so, you know, we'll see.
You see, because last year, I need to seek revenge, and yeah. I never got my revenge against Walter. He's off doing bigger and better things now, but I'm going to hold down from Pelican. So far in all my challenges today, I've not won any, and I've never won one in my entire career, so you better not let me win.
Well, I think if you had one practice last year with the weight, I think you'll be able to bomb the hammer pretty easily today.
Hopefully here in a second after your meeting is over with here, I can really show you how to throw a stick really far. That's all this sport is, people. That's all it comes down to. But anyway, let's see how I could turn out here at the field at Bernie Moore Track and Field Stadium. First challenger was javelin thrower Aaron Moore. Aaron showed me correct forms such as arm and body position. Let's see how I do against LSU's best. Because my first attempt was a failure, Aaron was lucky enough to spend some extra time with me and give me a second chance. And it didn't turn out any better.
How far would you say that went?
About 50 feet. So You're halfway there.
50.
More than that.
50 all day.
Next up was the jumping event. We spent some time with former LSU track star Zedrick Thomas. Zedrick represented Team USA in this year's Pan American Games. He first showed me the keys to the triple jump. Look at how beautiful this young man is. And next, he showed me how to correctly do a long jump.
Yeah, we made it.
But now, people, it's game time. All friendships are off. It's time for me to dominate in another challenge.
You're going to the Pan American Games, and I'm just a fat senior.
And on to my final competition, I challenge Max LaRoe, also known as Maximus Aurelius.
Fear the roar.
He showed me correct grip on how to correctly throw this metal ball of greatness. It's now on to the actual competition.
This is where Maximus Aurelius threw it over 230 feet. Now it's my turn. This is Spartan.
Look at him stretched up. My grip is right. Most importantly, my mind is set. Let's dominate, people. At first, I thought it threw it so far, I couldn't even find it. But of course, that wasn't the case.
Coach Shaver doesn't see this. I threw that thing. Max, of course, went over 230 feet, 16-pound weight, the male weight. I threw the female weight, which is 8 pounds, and I threw it about 30 feet. And too bad 20 of that feet is out of bounds here, and I broke the sprinkler system here. I guess I could say I lost this one really bad. That whole Sparta thing was really stupid. By the way, this is Carter Bryant for Pelican Sports, and yeah, I need to get out of here before they find me.
That's some pretty good stuff there, Richard. Carter Bryant, tip of the hat to Carter.
And let me just tell Carter this, a little inspiration. One day, Bob Mathias had the same dreams.
Did he?
And he went back-to-back decathlons for the United States.
Wow.
It can happen, Carter. It can happen.
It can happen, huh? Richard, it's been a lot of fun.
Same here, Tom. Appreciate you.
Are you off? I see we've got a couple schools closing for the LSU-BCS game in Baton Rouge.
Yes,
what is that?
My daughter's school.
They ought to close Tuesday, the day
St. Joseph's Academy and Catholic High's closing January
9th. You got 10 seconds. I mean, I didn't give you much time here.
I mean, Dominican's a sister school in New Orleans, close to the Dome, and Jesuits.
Okay. Hey, we hope you've enjoyed Tigers Roar. Spread the roar. We're here live every Wednesday night, 8 to 10 p.m., 2 complete hours. And if you're catching us Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you got a replay. Again, tip of the hat to Carter Bryant, Chris, on that great work on that Olympic track feature. Richard Condon, Tommy Chrysan, we'll talk to you again real soon on Pelican Sports TV.